Okay, we want to speak today about a topic called the spiritual role in a marriage for a man and his wife. And this is a very important idea that each one of us can implement in his house. And just to get some start off from last week's parasha, we see something interesting. Last week, when we spoke about Parashat Neso, the parasha starts in one thing, and then in the middle, it says, "Vayi beyom kalot Moshe lakim et ha-mishkan." When Moshe Rabbeinu completed the Mishkan, and then it says what happened then, "Vayimshach oto, vayikadesh oto, vayi beyom kalot Moshe lakim et ha-mishkan." First of all, interesting, the word kalot, Rashi brings down that some Sfarim say kalat, without the vav. What does it mean? So he brings over here, Yom hakamat ha-mishkan, ayu Yisrael kekala nichneset lachupa. Am Yisrael were like a kala going into the chupa. So it's time to know an idea, important idea, that always the Gemara in many places brings down that the Ma'amad Har Sinai is considered like Kiddushin. And over here we see Rashi points out that the building of the Mishkan was the Nisuin. As you know, in previous olden times, the Kiddushin and Nisuin were split into two different times. Today we do it together. Kiddushin means when the husband gives his kala the ring, and he says, "Arad mekudeshetli," so then she becomes his wife. That is the Kiddushin. That's the process called Kiddushin. That happened in one shalav, in one step, and then 12 months afterwards, there would be what we call today a chupa. What does it mean, a chupa? Today we do it with either the talit on top, or the cheder ichud, or other means. Back then, it would be done in two separate steps. One is the kiddushin, and then the chatan would go to his house, the kala to her house. The chatan would prepare for the marriage for 12 months. Normally, that would be the time gap. 12 months, he would get a house, he would make sure that his wife has everything she needs in the house, make sure that the house has everything that's needed, furniture, so on. And the kala would go and prepare for 12 months what she needs, all kind of jewelry, takshitim, whatever a woman needs to bring into the marriage. And then there would be the chupa. Over here, Rashi points out that the kiddushin of Am Yisrael to HaKadosh Baruch Hu was in Ma'amad Har Sinai, and the chupa was, as Rashi says here, Yom hakamat ha-mishkan, ayu Yisrael kekala nichneset lachupa. That was the building of the Mishkan. So it says over here in the parasha, Ve'i biyom kalot Moshe lakim et ha-mishkan. And then something happens over here that if you pay attention, you can learn a lot of musar, how a person should behave one to another. It says like this, Biyom kalot Moshe lakim, Rashi points out, Ve'lo ne'emar biyom hakim. He doesn't say at that day that he built up the Mishkan. Why? It only says at the day that he finished building the Mishkan, he completed building the Mishkan, and not at the day that he actually built the Mishkan. What does that mean? Rashi points out that for 7 days, Moshe Rabbeinu was building the Mishkan and putting it down. Building the Mishkan, putting it down. For 7 days, he was building it and taking it apart. Lo ne'emar biyom hakim, melamed shekol shivat yemei ha-miluim haya Moshe ma'amido u'mefarko. ובאותו יום העמידו ולא פרקו. The eighth day, ביום השמיני, Moshe Rabbeinu built the Mishkan, and he didn't anymore need to put it apart. What happened on that day? What happened on the eighth day? Why was Moshe Rabbeinu building up the Mishkan 7 days and taking it apart? What's the reason for that? For that, we need to go to Parashat Shmini. In Parashat Shmini, Rashi tells us the secret. And pay attention, it's unbelievable what goes on here. It says, in Parashat Shmini, ויבוא משה ואהרון אל אוהל מועד, משה ואהרון קם to El Moed on the eighth day. Ve'yetzu ve'yivarchu et ha'am ve'yira kvod Adonai el kol ha'am. On that day, on the eighth day, kvod Hashem, the Shechina HaKadosha, comes down. Why is that? Rashi points out the following. Rashi says, kol shivat ha'miluim she'emido Moshe el ha'mishkan ve'shimesh bo u'pirko b'chol yom lo sharta bo Shechina. Every day, from the eighth day, the 7 days of Yemei ha'miluim, the preparation for the Mishkan, Moshe Rabbeinu goes into the Mishkan and builds it up, and now he waits for the Shechina HaKadosha to come down to the Mishkan. But it doesn't happen. The first day, he builds up the Mishkan, nothing happened, he takes it apart at the end of the day. Second day, he puts it again, builds it up, Nothing happened. The Shekhinah doesn't come down again and again for 7 days. לפי שבכל שבעת ימי המילואים שהעמידו משה למשכן ושימש בו פרקו, בכל יום לא שרתה בו שכינה. שכינה would not come down. והיו ישראל נחלמים. עם ישראל felt bad. Imagine, you go and you wait and you participate and you look that maybe now the שכינה הקדושה will come down. First day, second day, seventh, עם ישראל will נחלמים. They started feeling that after so many days, שכינה doesn't come down, very, very bad. ואומרים למשה, משה רבנו, כל התורך שטרחנו שתשרה שכינה בינינו, we did so much in order for the שכינה to come down. It's not coming down, השכינה is not coming to us. ונדע שנתקבר לנו אבון העגל, they took a blame for it. We understand that this is because of אבון העגל, and we did so much that the שכינה would give us kapara, that the תשובה that we made, and building up the משכן and so on, and the שכינה doesn't come down. לכך אמר, זה הדבר אשר ציווה השם, תעשו, וירא אליכם כבוד השם. משה רבנו tells them, don't worry. It's all planned. It's all fine. Why is it? He says, אהרון אחי, כדאי וחשוב ממני. You should know that the only one that can bring down the שכינה הקדושה is my brother אהרון. אהרון אחי, my brother אהרון, חשוב וכדאי ממני. He's more important than me. He's more worthy than me. כשעל ידי קורבנותיו ועבודתו, תשכה השכינה ביניכם ותדעו שהמקום בחר בו. You want to know who Hashem chose? Hashem chose in Aaron. And you'll see, when Aaron will come to bring down the שכינה, you'll see that the שכינה will come down right away. Interesting. So Moshe Rabbeinu for 7 days tried to bring down the שכינה. He tells them, don't worry. Don't be so upset. Don't be נחלמים. Aaron will come, everything will be taken care of. So what happens over here? When the day of the eighth day, when they come down, the Shekhinah actually comes down when Moshe and Aaron go together into the place. Ve'evo Moshe ve'Aaron Elohel Moed. What did they do together over there? Says Rashi, Lama nichnas Moshe im Aaron? Why did they both go together? If Moshe Rabbeinu couldn't bring down the Shekhinah for 7 days, why are you going now together with Aaron? If Aaron knows how to bring down the Shekhinah by himself, let Aaron bring the Shekhinah. Why are you going in together with Aaron? כיוון שראה אהרון שקרבו כל הקורבנות, what happens? On the eighth day, everybody participates and looks at אהרון. אהרון is going to bring down the שכינה. But he sees אהרון goes and they bring קורבנות and קורבנות and קורבנות. On the eighth day, where everybody understands that Moshe Rabbeinu promised that when אהרון comes in, the שכינה הקדושה will definitely dwell on the מזבח, on the משכן. So he brings all the קורבנות ונעשו כל המעשים. ולא ירדה שכינה לישראל. Aaron tries everything, שכינה doesn't come down. והיה מצטער, he felt very bad. ואמר, יודע אני שכעס הקדוש ברוך הוא עליי, ובשבילי לא ירדה שכינה לישראל. משה רבנו understands and says to משה רבנו, Aaron says to him, I know that because of me the שכינה doesn't come down. אמר לו למשה, משה אחי, כך עשית לי שנכנסתי ונתביישתי, embarrassed me. Look at that, everybody's looking at me, the entire nation of Am Israel is looking at me. And the Shekhinah doesn't come down. It's very embarrassing. כך עשית לי ושנכנסתי ונתביישתי, you caused me the embarrassment. מיד נכנס משה עמו, ביקשו רחמים, ירדה שכינה לישראל. So משה רבנו says to Aaron, don't worry, I'll come in with you, and we bring down the Shekhinah. He goes inside, ביקשו רחמים, he asks הקדוש ברוך הוא, he prays, and the Shekhinah comes down. That's the story. When you learn the story over here, what Rashi tells us, it's magnificent. What happens over here? What happens in reality is that who brought down the Shekhinah? Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu comes on the eighth day and he brings down the Shekhinah. But he wants everybody to think that Aaron achi kedai v'chashuv mimeni. Aaron is more important than me. V'tiru sh'amakom bachar bo. You'll see that HaKadosh Baruch Hu chose Aaron and not me. And therefore Moshe Rabbeinu plans a whole game over here. First day comes in, and he tries to bring down the Shekhinah, nothing happens. He puts down the Mishkan, and he comes the next day. He builds it up, everybody's waiting, the Shekhinah doesn't come down. Puts again. So people come and ask him, what's happening? What's going on over here? Moshe Rabbeinu says, no, don't worry. When Aaron will come, the Shekhinah will also come in. And that's what happens on the eighth day. Aaron wasn't able to bring the Shekhinah. And Moshe Rabbeinu knew it all along. Moshe Rabbeinu comes in together with Aaron and he brings down the Shekhinah. Only to honor Aaron. They come out. Everybody thinks it's Aaron that's brought down the Shekhinah. But really, in reality, who was it? Moshe Rabbeinu. You hear the story of what goes on? That's a leader in Am Yisrael. A leader in Am Yisrael puts himself on the shadow. He makes people feel that he can't do it, when in reality, he's the only one that could bring down the Shekhinah, and he gives the full honor to Aaron. And that's where the day of the marriage between HaKadosh Baruch Hu and Am Yisrael, that to reflect on what exactly marriage is all about as well. Because when one does for the other, he should make the other one feel that everything is really him. He should make other people see that it's really the other person, it's not me. It's very much nogea in a marriage. Why? When a wife does so much in a marriage, she makes her husband feel that it's all about him. The husband goes out and he's all looking well, he's fed well. People don't know what goes on behind, but really it's the wife that works so hard behind the scenes in order that the husband would feel good. He dressed well, he looks well, he goes out. You can see the difference between a person that's married and not married. You can tell right away, a person that marries looks very different. He looks good, he looks much happier, he looks dressed well, he looks fed well, and so on and so forth. All of this is happening in a house. We have to have such a karat hatov as men. We have to have such a karat hatov that all is that is being done behind the scenes. Nobody outside knows. When we go out, we're not actually announcing this, that it's all about my wife and everything is she's doing. Rather, we go out, we feel good about it. You know, people give us the praise of the way we look, the way we dress. But really, in reality, we need to understand and give that hakarat hatov to whoever deserves that hakarat hatov. And that's where we're coming to our parasha. Our parasha, in parashat Be'alotcha, in the end of the parasha, we found that Moshe Rabbeinu is being spoken about by Miriam and Aaron. And that's what the pasuk says. V'tedaber Miriam ve'Aaron b'Moshe al odot ha'isha kushit asher lakach ki isha kushit lakach. When you read the psukim and you take Rashi and you try to understand what happened over here, it's very clear. Rashi tells us, what does it mean, kushit? Rashi four times over here emphasizes and tells us that kushit means beautiful. And it says the following, V'tedaber Miriam ve'Aaron b'Moshe al odot ha'isha kushit. They're talking about the beautiful woman. Kushit is a code for beautiful. Rashi tells us, isha kushit magid shakol modim beyofya, kashem shakol modim beshachruto shel kushit. Just like everybody would agree that a kushi is black, so do everybody agree that the wife of Moshe Rabbeinu Tzipora was beautiful. Magid shakol modim beyofya. And the Rashi says again, kushit begematria yefat toar. She was a beautiful woman. Al odot ha'isha ha'kushit, ki isha kushit lakach. That pasuk says twice, because he took a beautiful woman. Ma talmud lomar, what is the pasuk coming to tell us? Why does he need to repeat itself? Says Rashi, ela yesh lecha isha na'a biyofya ve'na na'a bimaseha. Some women are pretty, but they don't act nice. They don't behave nice. Yesh shena'a bimaseha ve'lo biyofya. Some women, they have such good midot, but they're not pretty. Aval zot na'a bakol. Tzipora was beautiful inside and outside. Aisha kushit, Rashi again says, al shem noya nikret kushit. Ke'adam ha'kore et b'no na'e kushi kedei shelo tishlot bo ayin ra'a. Just like a person calls his son in front of everybody, you kushi, you don't look good. Why? Ayin ra'a, he doesn't want ayin ra'a. So this woman was called isha kushit for ayin ra'a. Now I'm asking a simple question. What does the pasuk says? The pasuk says over here that Miriam and Aaron spoke about Moshe Rabbeinu. They have a complaint. How could you divorce a beautiful wife? What's wrong with you? You're divorcing a beautiful wife. A beautiful wife, you don't divorce. That's what the pasuk says. V'tedaber Miriam ve'Aaron b'Moshe al odot ha'isha kushit asher lakach. They're talking about the beautiful woman. We're emphasizing. That's what you emphasize about a woman, her beauty. There's so many good things about a woman. Why do you need to speak about the beauty over here? Ki isha kushit lakach, the claim and the blame on Moshe Rabbeinu, ki isha kushit lakach, he took a beautiful woman, why are you divorcing her? Rashi says he divorced her. Al odot girusheh, he divorced her. However you're going to learn Rashi, he did, he didn't, but whatever it is, They come in with Moshe Rabbeinu with a ta'ana, with a claim, you don't divorce a beautiful woman. And I'm asking a simple question. Moshe Rabbeinu cares about beauty. That's what they have a problem with Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu, how could you divorce a beautiful woman? A beautiful woman you don't divorce. That's what Moshe Rabbeinu cares about. If you take a look at Gdolei Israel, you take a look at Rav Chaim Kanievsky, you take a look at the Baba Sali, you take a look at Or HaChaim HaKadosh, they cared how the beautiful, how their wife looked. That's what they had in mind. They completely in all Torah and how to be mekayem mitzvot Hashem Yitbarach and the davuk in the Shekhinah, they care. Isha kushit lakach, which means she's a beautiful woman, she's not a beautiful woman. They come to say, how could you divorce a beautiful woman? That's not a ta'ana on Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu doesn't care about the beauty, right? That's not a reason for him to keep a wife if he needs to divorce her because she's beautiful. You know what the answer to this question? The answer to this question is that you need to realize that Chazal tell us in many places that there are tools that help a person get and elevate himself in Avodat Hashem. And the one that really elevates a person in Avodat Hashem the most, that's his wife. But in order to elevate a person in Avodat Hashem, she needs to have the right things. What is it? Inside beauty and outside beauty. Now, who says such a thing? First of all, if that's the pshat over here, that comes out very nice. That they come into Moshe Rabbeinu and they're telling him, how could you divorce a wife that really could be such a help for you in Avodat Hashem? She has an inside beauty and an outside beauty. What do you need more than such a push for Avodat Hashem? You could raise yourself so much in Avodat Hashem when you have everything you need. But that is what Chazal tell us in many places. Like for instance, the Gemara says in Shabbat Kafei, "Vatiznach mishalom nafshi nashiti tova." What does it mean? "My nashiti tova." Rabbi Abba Omer zo isha mekushetet etalmidei chachamim. A talmid chacham that has a wife that looks good, that helps out in Avodat Hashem. Peleplaim. Peleplaim. A talmid chacham, you have gdol ador. The Torah tells us in the Gemara that beauty of a wife can help out in Avodat Hashem. It says, for instance, in the Gra says, what does it mean? Sheker achen ve'evel ayofi. Isha irat Hashem, hi titalal. Beauty is nothing. Isha irat Hashem, hi titalal. But sheker achen ve'evel ayofi. That's nothing at all. The beauty of a wife is nothing. Says the Gra, unbelievable. It says like this. באמת מצינו גם האימהות אשר נשתבחו בחן ויופי וגם ברפקה כתיבה נערה טובת מראה מאוד. Which means the Torah keeps on praising the אימהות with their looks. How could that be? And if that's so, why does it say שקר אכן והבל היופי? Beauty is nothing, it's not important. And the answer the God says is the following. צריך לומר שהפירוש כך. שקר אכן והבל היופי היינו שהן בלתי יראת השם. When a woman is lacking יראת השם, so then שקר אכן והבל היופי. Her beauty means nothing. That's nothing at all, because she's lacking יראת השם. והם כנזם זהב באף חזיר. אבל אישה יראת השם, היא תתהלל, רוצה לומר, גם אכן והיופי תתהלל. Says the God the following. When a woman has beauty, whether it's inside beauty and outside beauty, that helps and enhances the avodat Hashem of a person when it's yirat Hashem ititalal. When she has yirat Hashem, then what's titalal? The beauty as well, which means it comes together to help out in avodat Hashem. When you have somebody that has yirat Hashem, and she has also chen veyofi, that adds up to help a person in Avodat Hashem. It's a beautiful concept. A person needs to remember that. But without Yirat Hashem, it means nothing at all. The chen and the sheker would be sheker achen vehefel ayofi. That's what counts by beauty. Beauty counts together with Avodat Hashem. That's what the Gra tells us. And he tells us another perush on something else as well. You know, the pasuk says, Al yitalel chacham bechochmato, gibor begvurato, ashir beoshro, ela, bazot, Hitalel amitalel, as kol ve'adorati. Person should not praise himself, not in his wisdom, not in his wealth, nothing, not in his strength, gibor, nothing. Don't praise yourself. Rather, only in Yirat Hashem. Says the Gra, a perush like this, that when you have Yirat Hashem, then you're allowed to be mitalel also in the other qualities that you have. In the osher, in the Gvura and everything else, the Chokhmah, the wisdom. Why? Because if you have Yirat Hashem, you're going to use that as a tool for Avodat Hashem. But if you don't have Yirat Hashem, so those things don't belong to you. Hashem gave you everything. The wealth, Hashem gave you. Liya Kesef Nuhum Hashem. The strength, of course you didn't give yourself. That's the way Hashem created you. And the same thing would be with the wisdom. Chokhmah that doesn't come from you, right? HaKadosh Baruch Hu already decides for a person 40 days before it's Yirat HaVlad, whether it would be Chacham or Tipesh. That's all decided by HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But if a person uses that for Avodat Hashem, so then when he has Yirat Hashem, everything else helps out, and for that he's well worth of the praise of that the Pasuk says over here. Says the Peloyetz the following. It says, Sheker achen ve'evel ayofi yirashai rat Hashem it italal, says the Peloyetz, Aval zehu kshu motze isha yafa ela she'ena yirat Hashem. When is it that Sheker achen ve'evel ayofi, that when you find a wife that doesn't have yirat Hashem. Exactly like the Gra. Az isha yirat Hashem, it italal, aval im motze yofi ve'irat Hashem, במקום אחד, בוודאי שיבחר, וקרב גם את היופי שהרי אמרו, אין אישה אלא ליופי. Which means like this. A beauty by itself means nothing. But when you take the beauty together with Yirat Hashem, that actually adds up to Avodat Hashem. And that's a very, very important concept. Chazal tell us, Gimel דברים מרחיבים דעתו של אדם. If you want to learn Torah, and you want to be able to be מרחיב דעתו, how do you actually become wiser, smarter? How do you actually accomplish more? Chazal say, there's three things that help you out. Bayit yaf na'e, dira na'a, kelim na'im, and isha na'a. Which means that Torah tells us that when a person has the beauty, that helps out in Avodat Hashem. This is what happens over here. You know, that we can say about Moshe Rabbeinu, as Or HaChaim HaKadosh says about Yaakov. Yaakov Avinu, when he saw Rachel, the Pasuk says over there about Rachel, Rachel hayta yifat toar, v'yifat mar'eh, beautiful woman. So why the Pasuk praises the beauty? Says Or HaChaim HaKadosh, al derech omram, bedin zivug letalmid chacham, shtzarich shtiyeh lo isha na'ah. A talmid chacham needs to have a beautiful wife. And that's why Yaakov Avinu had to have Rachel, which was beautiful. Why? Tzmachivim da'ato shel adam. It helps out in Avodat Hashem. Says the Or HaChaim HaKadosh, וגם שישתנה יעקב למעליות השם שולל מיצר הרע, יעקב אבינו doesn't care. יעקב אבינו is like Rav Chaim Kanievsky, יעקב אבינו is like הרב עובדיה יוסף. He doesn't care, what does he care? He cares about Torah only. Says the Or HaChaim HaKadosh, עם כל זה תלמד התורה לאדם דעת. Comes the Torah and teaches us what we need to do. The Torah doesn't speak about Yaakov necessarily. יעקב אבינו could be that he didn't care at all. But the Torah comes to teach us ללמד לאדם דעת, which means what is important, the Torah comes to teach us, which means that is something that's important. It comes out from this psukim, that is what Moshe Rabbeinu is blamed by Miriam and Aaron. How could you divorce a Isha Kushit, a beautiful wife? Moshe Rabbeinu cares about beauty? No, but that helps in Avodat Hashem. And she's not only beautiful on the outside, she's beautiful on the inside, which means she has the inside quality that actually makes the chen and the yofi such that help out Yirat Hashem. Has titalal. Then she should be praised. And that's what goes on over here. When we come to Matan Torah, we just received the Torah in Har Sinai, and we had Shavuot. And over there, it says the following in the Pasuk. It says, Moshe Allah אל האלוהים, ויקרא אליו אדוני מן ההר לאמור, כה תאמר לבית יעקב, ותגיד לבני ישראל. There's difference in the לשונות, as Rashi points out. Chazal points out that for בית יעקב, which are the ladies, it says כה תאמר. What does it mean כה תאמר? This is how you should speak. Rashi says, כה תאמר בלשון רכה. לבית יעקב ולא אנשים, תאמר להם בלשון רכה. תאמר, אמירה, is לשון רכה. תגיד לבני ישראל, עונשים ודקדוקים פרש לסחרים. When you come to speak to men, you speak to them עונשים ודקדוקים. Speak to them harshly. Scare them. Speak to them scary things. דברים הקשים כגידים. Tough things like כגידים. So I asked over here a few questions. We asked, one question is, what does it mean that you should speak to ladies belashon raka? The Rambam says in the end of Ilchot Tshuva that when you teach ladies, you should teach them meirah, fearful things. You should speak to them harshly when it comes to avodat Hashem. You want them to do avodat Hashem? Speak to them harsh things. Which means, Rashi say, the Rambam says over there, melamdim otam meirah. First you teach them things that are yirah. Yirat Hashem means fearful things. And then slowly, slowly, you teach them other things. But first, you start off with yirah. That doesn't fit this Rashi over here. It doesn't fit this Chazal over here. That's the first question. Second question is, what does it mean over here? The contrast of, for ladies, you speak lashon raka, and for men, you speak onashim v'dikdukim. Lashon raka means you speak to them softly, and for men, you teach them onashim v'dikdukim. That's not the opposite of speaking softly. The opposite should be that to men you speak harshly, not onashim v'dikdukim, peresh l'scharim dvarim kashim. And thirdly, what does it mean kashim? Kegidin, gidim. Gidim are not the toughest things that a person has in the body. You have atzamot, you have things that are stronger than gidin. Why does it pick out gidim over here? And we said the perush is the following. The perush over here is the following. You need to know that when you speak to ladies, not necessarily it's talking over here, speak to them softly or not. Lashon is also in Lashon HaKodesh. Lashon doesn't mean only the way you speak, but also a subject. If you take a look at Israel, they have such a thing called Lashon, Shiur Lashon, which means this is what you teach something. When you want to teach something, it's called Lashon. Lashon Raka means that when you speak to ladies, teach them Lashon Raka. Teach them things on the surface level, which means you come to teach them halachot. Ladies are not mitzuveh in Talmud Torah. You don't teach ladies the depth of the Torah. You teach them on the surface. Why is that message important right now? To ladies, is teach the halachot, the mitzvot, on the surface. To men, it says over here, dikdukim, onashim v'dikdukim, go with them into the depth of the Torah. Dvarim akashim kegidim, that's why it picks out gidim, because as you all know, that gidim are compared, the ramach and shasa. So that's compared to the mitzvot of the Torah. Ramach evarim v'shasa gidim. That is what the Rashi comes to point out over here. Kadvarim hakashim kegidim, like the mitzvot of the Torah, like the averot that you come in to learn, kegidim. So this is the way that things should be done. Rashi points out over here and says, Kotomar belashon hazeh vekaseder hazeh. Rashi tells us it's very important to go in order. First you speak to the ladies and then to men. Why? You know why? Because whether you like it or not, in a house, who maneuvers what's going to be? That's the wife. Men think that they are the ones wearing the pants. We all think that we are the one that deciding in the house. We are the one wearing the pants. But in reality, the truth is, everybody knows that a wife with a softness, she can change according to the way she understands, according to the way she wants things to happen. If she wants her husband to go and learn Torah, slowly, slowly, on the first day, the husband would say, I'm going to learn. But he wouldn't go, or I'm not going to learn, and he would stay in the house. But a wife with the softness, with the Lashon Raka, with the Chavivut, with the Mitikut Lashon, slowly, 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 she can convince her husband to do exactly as she understands, whether she wants him to learn or she doesn't want him to learn. Those that don't want their husband to learn, they want him to go to restaurants at night, to go with them out, to stay in the house. Slowly, slowly, she rubs it in until eventually he would stay in the house. It's all in the hands of the wife. Chazal tell us that everything is a kol min aisha. There's a chazal like that. That when a woman wants something, that's what's going to happen in the end. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu tells us that when you go to teach Torah to Am Yisrael, you go to see if Am Yisrael are willing to accept the Torah, kaseder hazeh vekalashon hazeh. Rashi tells us. Why does it need to be in that order? First you go to the ladies. Because if you convince the ladies, you convince the wives, that it's very important to teach Torah, to learn Torah, to keep the mitzvot, eventually you can go to the husband. So the wives, you don't need over here to go into depth. First you explain to the wives what's the importance of Torah. That's what the Torah tells us over here. And once they convince, once they understand it, once they're in it, eventually you can go to the men. And once you go to the men are willing to go and learn bedikdukim, v'onashim, and so on and so forth, as Rashi tells us. But that's to be starting for the wife first. And this is the Lashon of the Pasuk. Why is it called Kotomar Levet Yaakov? Ladies are called Bet Yaakov, Lashon Bait. Why? Because a woman actually wraps within her everything that happens in the house. If she decides she wants a certain way, that's the way it's actually going to lead in the end of the day. She wants him to stay home. In the first day, he'll go to learn or he'll go somewhere else. Second day, third day. But eventually, things will happen the way she wants. And that's a very important yisod. And that's why it's so important that a wife should understand what's important in the house. There's also importance for men to understand how to approach a wife, because if we understand that a wife has those powers, so we need to start getting her into the right way. Because if a wife doesn't want her husband to learn, she doesn't want him to go to pray in Minyan, so there's a way how to convince her also. You convince her, if she's convinced, if she's in it, in the end of the day, you'll go to a Minyan. If she's not in it, you weren't able to convince her, you didn't work on it, it's not going to happen. Very nice idea of that in Parashat Bechukotai. In Parashat Bechukotai, the Torah Kedosha tells us the value of people. Did you know people have value? It's called Erchin. Each person has a value according to his age. What's the value according to his age? For men it's one value, for women it's another value. Which means like this. If a man says, Erki alai, I want to give my value to Beit HaMikdash. There's a price to it. If I want to say, Erch ploni alai, I want to give the value of this person, there's a price to it. There's a price also, different price for a man and a woman. And those are the prices. The Torah says the following. Daber b'nei Yisrael v'amart aleim ish kefli neder v'erkecha nefashot l'adonai v'haya erkecha hazachar. How much is a man worth? Ben 20 shana v'ad ben 60 shana. If you're from 20 years old until 60 years old, v'haya erkecha 50 shekel kesef. Your value is 50. 50 shekel kesef. V'im nekeva, if it's a woman, v'haya erkecha 30 shekel. It's worth 30. A man is worth 50 at that age. A woman is worth 30. That is from the age of 20 until the age of 60. What if you less than 20? V'im ben 5 shanim v'aben 20 shana. If you're up to the age of 20, a man is worth 20 shkolim. V'ayar kecha azachar 20 shkolim v'lenekeva 10 shekalim. A woman is worth 10 shekalim. So what happens? What happens at the age of 20 that a man jumps from 20 to 50. Why? I was thinking a beautiful idea. You know what happens at the age of 20? Chazal tell us, a person should get married at the age of 18. But there's a deadline also to marriage. The deadline is 20. A person should not delay his marriage after the age of 20. Ben 20 ve'lo nasa isha kol yamav biurei avera. So therefore, they teach us over here that if you delay the age of 20, make sure you don't cross the age of If you delay the age of 18, don't cross the age of 20. If that's the case, we're talking about over here a person that's for sure married already, because by age of 20, the Torah takes for granted that people should be married. And that's what happens. You know, who's worth 30? That's the wife. At the age of 20, she becomes worth 30. But now she's also married. She married to the husband that's worth up to now 20. When you have the 30 of the wife and the 20 of the man, he's worth now 50. Why is that? Because a man is very different than a woman. When a man gets married, he doesn't have in mind only his wife. He wants to be successful in life as well. He wants to have a career. He wants to be successful within his community. He wants to be successful in many different ways. He also likes to be okay in the house as well. He also cares about his wife. But does he have his wife 100% on his mind all day? No. Then when he goes and does some business, he does it only for his wife? No. He'll give her what she needs. Part of it will go to his wife. But the reason he does business and he wants to be successful in business is because of his career. He wants to make money. He wants to get up there. But that's not the full reason that he's doing things because of his wife. But you know something? When a wife does something, she does it 100% for her husband. When she goes to work for her husband, for the wife, for the house. When she does something around the house, she cleans. She takes care of things. She goes shopping. She has in mind, this for my husband. That's what she has in mind. That's what in the back of the mind, sometimes it's on the forefront as well, of the mind of a wife always. And therefore, the Torah tells us over here, a person is worth 20 up to when he gets married. But when he gets married, he gets also another extra 30 bonus. That's his wife's 30. The wife's 30 that she's worth at the age of 20, he receives right now. And that's what we learned before. We said before that when you get that 30 from the wife, actually it's more than the 20 that he has for himself. He gets a 30 from his wife, obviously that has more weight to decide what's going to be around the house. And therefore, a wife can easily maneuver around the house what she wants. And that's why it's so, so important for women and men, for a wife and a husband to understand that. That when a wife pushes the right way, as we explained before, eventually she's going to reach what she wants. And therefore, it's very important to push in the right direction. And when a man understands that that's the strength and power of a wife, some men get married, they don't know that yet in the beginning. Those that are married already a few years know that very well. So therefore, we need to always try to convince the right way to the women as well. You know something very interesting. In the beginning of the Torah, Parashat Bereshit, when HaKadosh Baruch Hu creates Chava and he creates Adam, what does it say over there? First of all, the fact that the Chava was, the Isha is Ezer Kenegdo. It comes to support a person, to help him out. It's Ezer Kenegdo. But take a look at this story with the Nachash. It's an interesting story. It says in the story the following. Chava was approached by the Nachash, by the snake. And the snake asks her a question, why are you not eating from the tree? הנחש היה ערום מכל חיית השדה אשר עשה אדוני אלוהים, ויאמר אל האישה, אף כי אמר אלוהים לא תאכלו מכל עץ הגן. Why is it that you're not eating from the tree? So the wife tells him, ותאמר האישה אל הנחש, the woman tells him, מפרי עץ הגן נאכל, we can eat from the tree. But not that tree, not this specific tree, from other trees. ומפרי העץ, that tree, אשר בתוך הגן אמר אלוהים לא תאכלו ממנו ולא תיגעו בו, פנתם ותון. We're not allowed to eat from that tree that Hashem forbid us, and also Hashem didn't allow us to touch it. Good. ואומר הנחש אל האישה, so נחש goes into a convincing process. A whole process of how to get the wife or the isha, the woman, to eat from the tree. What does he say? ואומר הנחש אל האישה, לא מותם ותון. You should know, nothing's going to happen to you if you eat. And Rashi explains over here that he also made some manipulations, tachfach and agabo, he pushed her into the tree, she touched it, you see, nothing happens to you when you touch it. You need to know that the reason that HaKadosh Baruch Hu said don't eat from the tree, because if you eat to the tree, you're going to be like Hashem Yitbarach, and therefore, kol ba'aluman tzoned ba'alumnuto, Hashem Yitbarach doesn't want competition, he doesn't want you to be godly as well. And so he went through a whole procedure of trying to convince her. כי יודע אלוהים, כי ביום אכולכם ממנו ונפקחו עיניכם ואיתם כי אלוהים יודע טוב ורע. So then, after all this convincing, what happens? ותרא האישה כי טוב העץ למאכל. The woman sees that the tree is wonderful to eat. It's delicious. She sees the tree. Wow, delicious food. The תאווה started getting going. וכי תאווה הוא לעיניים. Not only it's delicious, but it also looks very, very good. Which means some people, when they come to eat, the look of the food is better to them, is more important to them than the taste. Some people like the taste. Some people, if it looks good, you go to a wedding, it depends how they set it up. It's the same food. They set it up all fancy way. You know, they make it look very, very good. So you come in, you enjoy the food much more. So over here it was, טוב העץ למאכל וכי תאווה הוא לעיניים. Not only that, ונחמד העץ להשכיל. Unbelievable kind of tree. Everything, all the qualities. So the woman, after the convincing of the Nachash, and it kept on going, it was a whole thing, as Rashi explained to us. It wasn't a second, it was a whole Masah Umatan over here. Eventually, in the end, what happens? ותיקח מפריו ותאכל. She fell. People fall down sometimes by the Tzara. That's it. Over here it was the Tzara b'chvodo v'atzmo. The Nachash, Mefarshim explains, was the Etzer Hara. He came in full force. The Nachash, that was the headquarters of the Etzer Hara, the head of the Etzer Hara, came in to try to work on the Isha, and eventually was able, so she fell. That's fine. But after a long convincing process, and after she saw all these beautiful things, Tova etzle ma'achal, ta'ava ula enayim, nechmada etzle askil, v'tikach mipiryo v'tochal. Now the next thing, I don't understand. V'titen gam le'isha ima v'yochal. She also gave the men, and he ate. Hey, what happened here? What happened to the convincing for the man? He also knows you're not allowed to eat from this. No convincing, no nachash that comes to try to push him to the tree, no, nothing. No tava ulayenayim, no tova etzle macha, no nechmada etzle askil, nothing. She gives it to the man and he eats. What happens here? It's an interesting thing. What's the answer to this? The answer is what we spoke before. That this is all true, that you need the convincing. Maybe if somebody strange will come to try to give the Adam the food or the fruits, the tree, maybe then they would have to go through all these things. But when we're talking about Chava, that his wife seems like it goes very, very easily. She just gives it to him and he eats it. It's a very interesting thing. It did nothing. And for Shim, don't say over here that there was any kind of Masa Umatan. She gave it to him and he ate. It's very, very strange. The answer is, as we're explaining right now, we're saying very important, that when we come to speak to the men are convinced right away when it's dealt with their wives. That's what happens. And that is the point that I'm trying to bring out, that it's so important that wives should understand that they hold in their hand very, very much. You know, the Chazal say that b'meishas nashim zachyan, what do ladies azoche? The fact that they send their wives to Bet Midrash and to learn, and the fact that they're waiting for them. What does that mean? What kind of thing is that? A wife is waiting home. She's doing whatever she wants. The man goes, and he toils, and he works, and he tries to understand. He learns the Gemara. He sweats. It's not easy to learn. You sit down and learn. It's very, very hard. People that really learn, yes, sometimes it's from the morning until the evening. People that learn in yeshiva and kolel, they go in the morning, come back in the evening. It's hard work. The wife is home. Now, women work very hard at home. I'm not saying not. But let's say it's such a woman that doesn't have to work hard. She has a maid. She doesn't have children yet. She has one kid. He goes to playgroup. He comes back. There's a maid that takes care of him. She doesn't work some way. Some people have that going for them. They don't have to work hard. So are they also included in B'mai Nashim Zachyan? For sure, because Chazal don't say the fact that she works in the house so hard, she takes care of the kid, she cooks, she bakes, she makes laundry, she goes shopping. Even without that, B'mai Nashim Zachyan, how they zoche, the fact that they send the husband to learn, and the fact that they're waiting for them when they come back. She doesn't go to sleep. Some women, the husband comes home, they're already sleeping 2 or 3 hours. They're already in bed. Over here it says, the fact that they're waiting for him. Very interesting. Why is that? The reason for that is because that is the support that she gives him. Support that the woman gives her husband doesn't have to be a financial support, doesn't have to be a support in any way, just to give him the chazak u'baruch, just to give him that, you are gdol ador for me, I'm looking up to you, you are so important. Go and learn. Comes back, I'm waiting for you. How was your day? Just the fact that she gives him that support, for that, Nashim Zachyan, she splits with him everything that he learns. Everything that he learns belongs to her as well. As Rabbi Akiva said to his Talmidim, Sheli veshelachem shelau. Everything belongs to her. Why? She sends him. That's it. She sends him. He came back after 24 years. She's waiting for him. Wow. 24 years, Rabbi Akiva learns. The students learn, everything belongs to her. How could that be? You see that power of sending the husband to do the right thing? That gains you everything. That's unbelievable. That's unbelievable. It doesn't say anything more than that. It's not the schuyot, that the fact that she sends. No, because if she wouldn't be supportive of her husband, go and learn, Rabbi Akiva wouldn't go. He wouldn't go. He would go for a short time and come back. What pushed him for going and staying and afterwards coming back after 12 years and seeing that he can go again without saying hello to his wife? That push that she gave him, that support that she gave him, that okay that she told him in the beginning, and that kept him going the whole time through and through. That's a message that we need to know today. After Kabbalat HaTorah, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, first you speak to the ladies, convince them and go and speak to the men. We need to know as men, we need to convince our wife on the right way because they have the power. And the wives should know that they need to give that support, whatever it is. It's where they're going to learn. It's where they're going to do the right things. It's all kind of different right things for each and every family. How do you know what's the right thing? If you don't know, ask your rabbi. You need to have some guidance. But whatever is the right thing, make sure that always you will strive to do the right things. And this is the message that we learn in our parasha, last week's parasha, in Shavuot, and from the beginning of the Torah until the end of the Torah. Thank you very much.